I want to introduce our next storyteller, Buck Bannister.
You know, today, if you want a recipe, it's really easy just to go online, type something into Google, and get back, you know, 1,000, 2,000 variations on the same recipe. But back in my mama's day, recipes were handed from one person to the next. And a lot of times, those recipes were written down on sales receipts or on the back of deposit slips, back before the days of debit cards. But they were passed from one person to the next. And my mom actually carried a little spiral notebook in her pocketbook. And for those of y'all who aren't from the South, a pocketbook is a purse. And she would write down recipes from the people gave her, that she saw in a magazine or whatever. And this is actually a story of how she came to get one of those recipes. In 1988, I was a student at Piedmont Technical College in Greenwood, South Carolina, and I happened to be the top academic achiever in my class, so I was elected to go to a medical seminar in New Orleans. And Mama went with me. My brother was a travel agent. He was actually a regional manager for AAA. And he arranged for us to have a 5-star hotel. And that was quite something, because Mama was, first of all, looking forward to New Orleans, because to her it was an exotic place. She thought everybody in New Orleans spoke French and spoke English with a Cajun accent, because her entire concept of New Orleans was a bunch of people like Justin Wilson from the old Cajun Cook TV show running around talking to each other. I was looking forward to it because I had spent my summers with my brother in California going around to some of the nicest hotels and things on the West Coast, and I had become quite addicted to the good life. Mama, on the other hand, couldn't care less. Her idea of a great time was when I was a kid, packing us all up in the car at 4 o'clock in the morning and driving us down to Myrtle Beach, South Carolina, which was about 2.5 hours away. And when we got there, she would put blankets in the car windows and we would change into swimsuits and we would go play in the ocean. And then when the sun went down, we would get back in the car and we would drive home. That was a vacation. So you can imagine, 5-star hotel, Mama, this is gonna be good. So we arrive in New Orleans, pull up in front of the Omni, Royal Orleans, and I pop the trunk, and the bellman comes out to get the bags with his cart, and Mama looks at me and she says, "What's he doing?" And I said, "He's getting the bags, Mama." And she jumped out of the car, walked to the back of the car, looked at the man and said, "He can get those." I said, "Mama, it's his job." She said, "You can get those. He can leave that little cart. You can push it in." After a few tense moments, she finally agreed to allow them to take the bags out of the cart and go in with me to check in. So we finally made it to the room, and my brother had outdone himself. We had a nice suite with a sitting area and 2 bedrooms. And a bathroom that Mama swore was as big as her living room. And so she was looking around the room, and I was conducting business with the bellman. And finished up, turned around, and there's Mama. "How much did you give him?" I said, "Mama, don't worry about it. It's okay. It's fine." "Well, I don't see why in the world anybody has to have a tip for doing their job. Nobody ever tips me. I stand in the shoe store all day long trying to fit them women's fat feet in shoes that are 2 sizes too small because they're too vain to buy the right size. And then the ones come in with their smelly feet, they won't even wear a hose, know they're not going to buy the shoes and want to try them on anyway, and nobody ever gives me a tip." I said, "Oh God, not the tip rant." Wasn't that Mama was cheap. She just didn't really think that people should get money for doing things that they're already paid to do. And if you're paid to bring in luggage, that's what you do. So we finally settled down for the evening. Well, there was one minor little thing, because the hotel had a coffee maker on the vanity in the bathroom, and that was considered quite odd. Why couldn't they put the coffee maker on the table by the window? Why does the coffee maker have to be in the bathroom? Who ever heard of putting a coffee maker in the bathroom? The next morning, I was up at the crack of dawn and had to go to my seminar. So I called down to the concierge and had him send up some brochures for things for Mama to do, because I was going to be gone all day. And so as I was getting ready to leave, I'm trying to convince Mama to go out and do something. I said, Mama, you know, look, there's, you know, look at the beautiful church that's over there. You know, we could actually see St. Louis Cathedral from the window. I said, look at the beautiful church. You could go see the church. What kind of church is it? Oh, God. It's a Catholic church. Well, I can't go. I'm a Methodist. Yes, you can, Mama. It's open to the public. Anybody can go in. Uh-huh. Don't you have to wear a hat or something? I don't think so, Mama. Well, what if they're giving communion? I said, well, I don't think they'll make you take it, but I don't think they are. She said, well, it would be rude of me not to take it if they were serving. Finally, I left and went to the seminar. I was gone about 7 hours and came back hoping that my mother had ventured out of that room. It was a vain hope. I opened the door. There's Mama sitting at the table by the window with her feet popped up on a chair, with her best slippers on and her house coat at Southern for a nightgown. And all these papers spread across the table, and cheese crackers, packets of cheese crackers. But what was really surprising was there was a woman sitting at the table next to her, an elderly African-American lady wearing a hotel maid uniform with her feet up on a chair and her shoes kicked off. And I said, Mama, what you been doing? And she said, oh, honey, this is Martha. She's the maid. I said, I see that. Yeah, well, she came by earlier to clean, and, well, you know, the room wasn't dirty because we was only here last night. So I told her wasn't no need for her to come in clean right now. So she came back when she got off work to see if we wanted something, and we got to talking about food and whatnot, and we decided we'd just sit here and share some recipes. I said, so that's what you've been doing. You've been sharing recipes all afternoon. Yeah, oh, we've just had the best time. You know, Martha's family has been here for 300 years, but they weren't slaves like the black folks back home. I could feel the blood drain from my face as the lightheadedness came over me, and I said this silent prayer. Oh, dear God, if you are a merciful God, you will strike me dead right now and open up the earth and let it swallow me, because I was sure that Martha was going to be very offended. Much to my surprise, Martha was beaming. It was evident that she was quite happy of her family history as freedmen. So they finished up doing their recipes. Martha got up and left, and I said, Mama, at least I guess you went downstairs to get some cheese crackers. She said, no, I didn't. She said, I had those in my pocketbook. Because, you know, if you have to buy things out of the vending machine at a motel, you're going to pay two prices. I said, Mama, why didn't you go out and do anything? She said, well, baby, if I was going to go out and see New Orleans, I want to do it with somebody I love. She said, I don't want to go out there by myself. She said, so I just decided I'd wait here till you got back. And she said, then Martha came and we had a good time sitting here talking. So we'll see things tomorrow. And that's what we did. The next day, we went out to see New Orleans, or as much of New Orleans as we could see, in a driving rainstorm that happened to be the leading edge of a hurricane. Travel tip. If you were trying to be a fancy traveler, check the weather report. One of the recipes that Martha gave Mama that day was for a Mardi Gras cake. And this is not a king cake like you guys may be familiar with. Mardi Gras cake is something that the family served each other, not something that served at parties. And that became one of Mama's favorite recipes the last 15 years of her life after that. And I still make that cake today. And every time I do, I think about Mama and Martha in New Orleans and bathroom coffee. And really enjoy it. A few years ago, I was very sick. And I had to go to Charleston, South Carolina with my sister for tests because I needed a liver transplant. And they had to figure out whether I would live through the surgery. So we got down there, went to one of my favorite hotels, which, while not five-star, does have a bellman, and pulled up in the rainstorm. My sister helped me out of the car, and I was standing in the foyer, tottering on a cane because I could barely walk at the time. I was so sick. And the bellman came out and helped me inside into the lobby and showed me to a chair. And he said, I'm going to go help get the bags out of your car. And without thinking about it, I said, oh, no, that's okay. She can get them. And it was at that moment I realized I am my mama.